14, Leonard Bosman, a Jewish theosophist and Freemason from London, wrote in his book, The Music of the Spheres, concerning people who deny that Judaism can be reconciled with theosophy. Have they heard about the inner doctrine, the received wisdom, the Kabbalah, or the doctrine of the heart, or the theosophia of the Jews? But verily, the secret doctrine of the Jews is theosophia, and nothing but theosophia. And hence it is a matter of perfect simplicity to reconcile the two teachings that emanate from one source. Similar perceptions concerning the significance of Kabbalah, the essential identity of Kabbalah and theosophy, were prevalent among Jewish followers of the Theosophical Society. Following the notion that Kabbalah enables the reconciliation between Judaism and theosophy, many Jewish theosophists studied Kabbalah, wrote articles and books about Kabbalah and Hasidism, and created theosophical-inspired modern forms of Kabbalah. In my lecture today, I would like to examine the interest of Jewish theosophists in Kabbalah, discuss the theosophical interpretation of Kabbalah, and analyze the context and significance of the Jewish theosophical adaptations of Kabbalah. The first part of my lecture, I will discuss the history of Jewish theosophists and the formation of the Jewish theosophical groups. In the second part of my lecture, I will examine the interest of Jewish theosophists in Kabbalah and their perceptions and adaptations of Kabbalah. And finally, I will discuss the context and significance of the Jewish theosophical reading of Kabbalah and their place and impact on modern understanding on formations of Kabbalah. Before beginning my lecture, I would like to thank many people who helped me and enabled my research. There's a long list of scholars, librarians, and members of the Theosophical Society that supplied me with information, sent me photocopies, hosted me, encouraged me, and went out of their way to help me in my research, and I will just mention a few of them. First, Pat Devaney, who kindly gave me information he gathered concerning early Jewish theosophists. And you gave me a lot of material, so even if you look surprised now. Janet Kirshner, the archivist of the Theosophical Society in America, that hosted me kindly in Wheaton and helped me so much during the last years, supplied me with invaluable information. Michael Gomez, the director of the Emily Sellen Memorial Library in New York, who helped me, and Barry Thompson, the librarian of the Theosophical Society in London, Renger Dijkstra from the Amsterdam Theosophical Society, the librarians at the Adyar International Headquarters, John Algeo, the former president of the American section of the Theosophical Society, Mary Anderson, the former international secretary of the Theosophical Society, and many others who were very kind and helped me a lot in this research. From the very beginning of the foundation of the Theosophical Society in 1875, Jews joined and were active in the Theosophical Society. Already in the first circle of the founders of the Theosophical Society in New York, there was a Sephardi Jewish scholar, originally from England, a Freemason, who was affiliated with Reform Judaism, David E. De Lara. About him, Pat Devaney wrote an interesting article. In 1882, after Blavatsky and Olcott moved the headquarters of the Theosophical Society in India, A.D. Ezekiel, a Jew from the Iraqi Jewish community in Pune, had joined the Theosophical Society, and I mentioned him this morning. After joining the Theosophical Society, Ezekiel began to study Kabbalah, translated Kabbalistic texts to Jewish Arabic, and published an introduction to Kabbalah in English, and a story entitled The Jewish Kabbalist from Jerusalem, which he published in The Theosophist. In the late 1880s, in Vienna, yeah, Friedrich Eckstein, who was a friend of Freud, was interested in theosophy, met Blavatsky, he founded the Vienna Lodge of the Theosophical Society, and was its first president, and through him, at least I read that Steiner became interested in theosophy. Ernst Müller, about whom we will hear more tomorrow from Andreas Kirscher, was also active in the Viennese Lodge and later became a follower of Steiner. in Prague, in the first decade of the 20th century, a circle of theosophists, most of them Jewish, headed by Berta Fanta. And we will hear more about her and her circle tomorrow in Zohar Maor's lecture. In 1911, Steiner gave lectures to the Fanta, circle, and among the participants was one Franz Kafka and Hugo Bergman, who later married Elsa Fanta's daughter, later immigrated to Palestine and became the first rector of the Hebrew University. And he was very much interested in Steiner's idea throughout his life. At the same period, in South Africa, the first lodge was founded in the first Theosophical Lodge was founded in 1899 in Johannesburg by Louis Rich. Other Jewish theosophists were active in the lodge, all of them related to Gandhi, Herbert Kitchen, Henry Pollack, and Hermann Kallenbach, that we see in the picture with Gandhi, and about him, I'm giving the promo to all kinds of lectures tomorrow, we'll hear more from Shimon Lev tomorrow. In Italy, in Livorno, I have learned from Marco Passi, haven't found any material about that, apart from what you mentioned in an article, Jewish students of the famous rabbi of Livorno, Eliyahu ben Amozag, joined the Theosophical Society, Amozag. In England, in the first decade of the 20th century, there were several Jews active in the Theosophical Society, and I will mention just some of them. Joshua Abelson was a liberal rabbi, a scholar of Jewish studies, was affiliated with the Theosophical Society since the first decade of the 20th century. He lectured in Theosophical lodges and published articles in Theosophical journals. He was in touch with George Mead, Blavatsky's former secretary, and published books about Kabbalah and Jewish mysticism, one of the first books, Introductions to Kabbalah and Books About Jewish Mysticism, in 1913. The book was published in Mead's Quest series. Later, by the way, he wrote the introduction to the large English, first English translation of the Zohar, the Sonsinusol translation. Elias Gewurz immigrated to London in 1902 from Dembitz in Poland. He was a descendant of quite a known rabbinic family, joined the Theosophical Society, published articles and books on Kabbalah, and in 1914 immigrated to California and was active in the Theosophical Society there. His student, Leonard Bosman, from one of his books, I read the citation in which, with which I began this lecture. He was from a Jewish-Dutch family, a theosophist, a Freemason, and published several books about theosophy, Judaism, and Kabbalah. There were many more Jews who joined the Theosophical Society in the late 19th, early 20th century, and were influenced by it. I just mention just one more interesting person, Naftali Herz Imber, a famous Zionist poet, author of Hatikva, which became the anthem of the State of Israel, immigrated in the 1880s from East Europe to Palestine, resided with Lawrence and Alice Oliphant in Haifa. Later, he immigrated to the United States and there was in touch with theosophists, took part in the 1895 Theosophical Convention in Boston, quite an important convention, and was very much influenced by theosophical ideas. Although many Jews were active in the Theosophical Society, it was only 50 years after the establishment of the Theosophical Society that a Jewish Theosophical Association was founded. In December 1925, a few Jewish theosophists met at the Jubilee Congress of the Theosophical Society at Adyar. Among them were Gaston Pollack, who was the General Secretary of the Theosophical Society in Brussels, G. H. Perez from Cairo, M. Cohen from Sofia, Bulgaria, and Pia Muller from Trieste, Italy. Other Jewish delegates were from the three major Indian Jewish communities. Amongst them was Samuel Suleiman Cohen, who arrived from Iraq and later became one of the prominent disciples of Sri Ramana, A.B. Abraham Barak Salem, a lawyer, political and social activist from the Jewish community in Cochin. Later, he became a Zionist activist and organized the immigration of the Cochin Jewish community to Israel. Dr. Jacob E. Solomon, a medical doctor from the Jewish community in India, the Bnei Israel, was a medical doctor, a social activist, political leader from Ahmedabad. The Jewish delegates decided to establish the Association of Jewish Theosophists. They conducted a ceremony in Hebrew, and Annie Besant laid this foundation stone for a synagogue at the Adyar compound. The declared objects of the associations were, and I will not read everything, but especially to study Judaism in light of theosophy and theosophy in light of Judaism, to spread theosophical teaching and to spread theosophical teaching among the Jews. In the next few years, the association published a few books, tried to raise funds for the building of the synagogue, which still isn't built there, and established the local sections of the Association of Hebrew Theosophists. Branches were founded in England, Holland, India. Also, there were representatives in Austria, Poland, Bulgaria, Romania, and Italy. The most active group of the Association of Hebrew Theosophists was in the United States. The president of the American sections was Henry C. Samuels from Seattle. He immigrated as a child from Russia. He published several books, one of them, Krishnamurti, the Jew. The vice president, Gotsena Boridlova, from Milwaukee. She was author of several articles and books on the occult significance of numbers. Local groups of American section were founded in different locations and held meetings and lectures. Henry Samuels, the president, edited a journal, The Jewish Theosophists, which appeared in 1926 to 1927, then one issue in 1930, and a few more issues in 1932. And I should thank Jonathan Meir, who supplied me with photocopies of one of the issues that I couldn't find elsewhere. In the journal, there were many articles concerning theosophy and Judaism, many of them related to Kabbalah and Hasidism. Gradually, the activity stopped. Members of the association were still active in the Theosophical Society in later years, but they haven't found any information about activities of the Association of Hebrew Theosophists after 1932. Yet, at the same period, there was another Jewish theosophical group that was active, independently from the Association of Hebrew Theosophists, in Basra, Iraq. In 1926, Kaduri Ani, whose brother, Reuven Ani, was active in the Theosophical Society in India, established a Theosophical Lodge in Basra. In 1928, Ani got into a dispute with other members of the Jewish community concerning the council taxes. His opponents informed the rabbis of Baghdad of Ani's involvement with the Theosophical Society. The rabbis issued a ban against Aini and other Jews who participated in the activities of the Theosophical Society. Kadur Aini and his supporters, not all of them were members of the Theosophical Society, about 300 families, seceded from the Jewish community and established their own Jewish, Theosophical-oriented congregation, with their own rabbi, synagogue, school, slaughterhouse, and graveyard. The community existed until 1936. In 1936, a truce was achieved between the theosophists and the rabbis, the ban removed, and the theosophical-oriented community dissolved. In 1945, Kaduri Aini and his family immigrated to Israel. Since the 1930s, no more activities of Jewish theosophic groups that I know of. Yet, some former activists continued writing on theosophy and Judaism. I should mention that in the 1950s, an Israeli section of the Theosophical Society was established. One of the founders was affiliated with the earlier Jewish Theosophical group, that was Rosa Ani. I don't know if you can see here, the meeting of the Lodge Moria took place in Balfour, Eingang um die Ecke, yeah, by Schwester Rosa Ani, yeah, the wife of Kaduri Ani. By the way, this is very close to Bibi Netanyahu's house today.
Prime Minister.
Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu, yeah. No. Okay. A few words now on Theosophy and Kabbalah. Most of the Jewish Theosophists I mentioned were interested to preserve their Jewish identity. The idea behind the association of Hebrew Theosophists was to create a Jewish theosophical framework. Kabbalah played a central role in the attempts of Jewish Theosophists to accommodate Judaism and Theosophy. As it is well known and we hear today, Kabbalah had an important role in the writings of the early Theosophists, especially Madame Blavatsky. Blavatsky's perception of Kabbalah, which were examined by Marco Passi in his article on Oriental Kabbalah and by Julie Hayes in the 10th chapter of her dissertation and in the lecture that we heard today, As Passi and Hayes showed, although Kabbalah had a central place in Blavatsky's writing, she had an ambivalent stance towards Jewish Kabbalah. She downplayed the connection between Kabbalah and Judaism, and she downplayed the connections between Kabbalah and Judaism. Following the interest in Kabbalah in the Theosophical Society, the Jewish Theosophists studied, translated, and wrote much about Kabbalah and Jewish mysticism, and this is just a small sample. Amongst them were the people I mentioned, A.D. Ezekiel, Elias Gewurz, Leonard Bosman, Ernst Müller, Joshua Eibelson, Butzaina Bridlova, and many others. Kabbalah was perceived by the Jewish Theosophists as compatible, many times as identical with Kabbalah. For instance, Bosman wrote in the passage I started my lecture with, "But verily the doctrine, the secret doctrine of the Jews is Theosophia and nothing but Theosophia," okay, that I mentioned, "and hence," that I read for, "and hence it is a matter of perfect simplicity to reconcile the two teachings which emanate from one source. The inner teaching of Judaism is the same as that offered in the secret doctrine. The very name of the book of Zayan, from which the secret doctrine was taken, and the Kabbalistic work called the Book of Zniuta, being similar in construction and purpose." Similarly, before, A.D. Ezekiel, in the story he wrote, he published in the Jewish Theosophist, he wrote, "These doctrines promulgated by the Theosophical Society are identical with those taught by the Kabbalists of our race. There is the same rule of life, the same goal to reach." Most, possibly all, Jewish Theosophists became interested in Kabbalah following their interest in Theosophy. And I should mention that in the late 19th and early 20th century, liberal, westernized Jewish circles, to them most of the Jewish Theosophists belonged, had very little acquaintance and knowledge of Kabbalah, and sometimes they had a negative attitude, which was characteristic of the Jewish Enlightenment. Thus, for instance, Ezekiel tells about his road to studying Kabbalah. 10 years ago, some people came from America who called themselves the Sufi Society. This is translated from Jewish Arabic, and Nurit Inbar is sitting there, and she was the first to help me read this text in Arabic before I turned also to Sasson Somech. So it's interesting, he calls the Theosophical Society, he calls them in Arabic, Sufi Society. "I met them and joined their society 5 years ago. I have seen from their writing that much of their movement was based on our Kabbalah. The members of the Sufi Society that came to Bombay were not Jewish. I was very much astonished that foreign people were experts in our wisdom of Kabbalah, while we, the Jews, were barred from it. So, after much effort and sleepless nights, I studied a little of it, and what I have studied, I will reveal to my brethren. Similar, Bosman, a similar story. Yeah? The writer, brought up in a fairly orthodox surrounding from which he and the whole of a large family later fell away because of the lack of reality behind the too rigid forms and customs. In later years, however, thanks to the light shown him in a peculiar manner, he was attracted to Theosophical Society and there found the light of Judaism, which had long eluded him, and it is clear that the light of Judaism is Kabbalah. The Jewish Theosophists gave a theosophical interpretation and adaptation of Kabbalah. They emphasized the elements that were compatible with Theosophy and created Theosophical forms of Kabbalah. This theosophical reading of Kabbalah comes to the fore, for instance, in Elias Gruevaerts, the teacher of Leonard Bosman, in his Beautiful Thoughts of the Ancient Hebrews. And there he, well, this, okay, I read the passage. The principal textbook of the Kabbalah, the Zohar, contains a great variety of teaching on the inner life. The most prominent among them are the three doctrines of the unity of God and the universe, the law of cause and effect, and the law of spiritual evolution by means of rebirth. The immortal merit of Kabbalistic writing is their freedom from dogma and from all sorts of limitations in regard to race, creed, or color, and you see, of course, the theosophical understanding of Kabbalah as theosophy. In the framework of the theosophical interpretation of Kabbalah, Jewish theosophists adopt a Christian Kabbalistic and Western esoteric perspective of Kabbalah and its place in Judaism, which includes a differentiation between Kabbalah and Rabbinic Judaism, a positive perception of Kabbalah as a vital spiritual element in Judaism, and a negative perception of Rabbinic, Halachic, Talmudic Judaism. This perception comes to the fore in Butsena Bridlova's article in the Jewish Theosophist about the ancient Kabbalah. The Kabbalah and its principles are applicable admirably to our own time, much in contradistinction to the Talmud, which in modern days seems dreadfully useless and unpractical with its laws that were established to govern conditions that we have long outgrown. The Kabbalah made a strong appeal to the poor, struggling creatures who were literally crawling along in the mud of despair under the yoke of operation and sect tradition. Another example from Alex Horn, that the Kabbalists profoundly influenced Jewish life and thought, there can be no doubt. They tried to draw religious life away from the dry and meaningless repetition of acts and formulas. They strove to inject religious devotion and true faith into observances that were fast becoming perfunctory, etc. In difference to Blavatsky and other non-Jewish theosophists, who had an ambivalent stance to Jewish Kabbalah and claimed that Kabbalah originated outside of Judaism and downplayed the connection between Kabbalah and Judaism, Jewish theosophists emphasized the Jewish origin and nature of Kabbalah. For instance, H. Blumenfeld, I didn't mention him before, but in an article entitled Theosophy in Kabbalah, Theosophy is a correct prototype of the Kabbalah of old, born in old Palestine and nursed at the breast of Zoroastric philosophy, and in former Talmudic days looked upon as divine revelation. Kabbalah and theosophy are thoroughly Jewish. We recognize the Kabbalah and all pertaining to theosophy as twin sisters. The Jewish theosophists believed they had a double mission, to increase knowledge about Judaism, especially Kabbalah amongst the theosophists, and to help Jews to better understand Judaism through Theosophy and Kabbalah, and this comes to the fore, and I will not read it, in the objects, the stated objects of the Association of Hebrew Theosophists. The aspiration of the Jewish Theosophists was to revive Judaism in a theosophical spirit through a revival of Kabbalah as part of Jewish spiritual national revival. And indeed, most Jewish theosophists were sympathetic to Jewish nationalism, and many were Zionists, active Zionists. Bosman, in continuation of a passage I cited before, wrote, "Having found the light, he," that means the author, Bosman, "in company with other Jewish theosophists, is anxious to share it with his compatriots. Hence the new movement, founded within the Theosophical Society to revivify Judaism by seeking to bring back to it the deeper truths so long overshadowed by materialistic wanderings." I would like to start and conclude. Oops, didn't see that. Jewish theosophists created theosophical-inspired interpretations of Kabbalah, contributed to the modern understanding of Kabbalah in neo-romantic and Western esoteric perspective, which were derived from mostly from earlier Christian perspectives. The Jewish theosophists' perception of Kabbalah and their contribution to the formation of modern forms of Kabbalah is part of a larger current of modern Jewish interest and revival of Kabbalah under the impact of neo-romantic and esoteric movements. The interest in Kabbalah, its valorization, universalistic interpretation, its spiritualization and mystification, the dichotomization between Kabbalah and Rabbinic Judaism, the role of Kabbalah in Jewish national revival, merges and overlaps with similar tendencies in the late 19th and early 20th century Jewish thought. The Jewish theosophists' perceptions of Kabbalah are similar in many aspects to perceptions of Kabbalah found amongst late 19th and early 20th century national neo-romantic Jewish scholars such as Hillel Zeitlin, Martin Buber, and Gershom Scholl. Some of these perceptions became central in the modern academic study of Kabbalah. And as I mentioned, some Jewish theosophists contributed to modern Kabbalah scholarship, including Bergman, Miller, and Abelson. From this perspective, it is significant that Scholem chose the term theosophy as the most appropriate term to describe Kabbalah. Scholem wrote in Major Trends in Jewish Mysticism. Scholem, Gershom Scholem. "If I were asked to characterize in one word the essential trait of this word of Kabbalistic thought, I would say that the Zohar represents Jewish theosophy. That is, a Jewish form of theosophy. By theosophy, I mean that which was generally meant before the term became a label for a modern pseudo-religion. In case it is not clear to him with whom he is referring, Scholem adds a note to the last words, in which he discusses the possible connection between Blavatsky's book of Zeyan and Sifrat Zetzniuta, and says, "The first to advance the theory without further proof was L.A. Bosman, a Jewish theosophist, in his booklet, The Mysteries of Kabbalah. This seems to me the true etymology of the hitherto unexplained title. This bibliographical connection between the fundamental writing of modern and of Jewish theosophy seems remarkable enough." Notwithstanding his reservation and disparagement of the Theosophical Society, Scholem's understanding of the meaning of theosophy and of Kabbalah as Jewish theosophy is not that far from the theosophist's understanding of the term. And I go back to the text, continuing where I stopped with the note. "Theosophy signifies a mystical doctrine or school of thought, which purports to perceive and to describe the mysterious working of the divinity. Theosophy postulates a kind of divine emanation whereby God, abandoning his self-contained repose, awakens to mysterious life." Now, I don't want to claim that modern scholarly definition of Kabbalah as Jewish theosophy was derived from the Theosophical Society. Indeed, Kabbalah was sometimes described as theosophy since the middle of the 18th century. Yet, I believe that the use of the term theosophy as a central term in both Kabbalah scholarship and the Theosophical Society is significant and highlights the shared context and mutual impact between modern Jewish scholars of Kabbalah and the Jewish followers of the Theosophical Society. Paraphrasing Scholem's assertion concerning the connection between Sifra de Tzniuta and the Book of Zayan, I would like to conclude my lecture by saying that the terminological connection between the fundamental writing of modern Kabbalah scholarship and of the Jewish theosophies seems remarkable enough. Thank you.
Thank you for this remarkable paper. You're perfectly in time. Thank you for that too. The discussion is open. Marco?
I wanted to hear something more about the relationship to Zionism, because probably this is one of the interesting aspects of this story. I think you said that many of these Jewish theosophies were Zionists. Is that so? Or?
Well, in a journal article about Jews in India, there was a mention of the community, I think in Bombay, and it said that half of the members of the Zionist organization in Bombay were theosophists.
Which doesn't say how many of the theosophical lodge were Zionists.
Yeah, of course, of course. But
but it's remarkable enough.
It is remarkable enough, of course, that was the... of course, Miller was and Bergman were a Zionist activist. I mentioned Imber, who wasn't really a member of the Theosophical Society, but it was an apparent Zionist. The Jewish theosophist had, since the beginning, published a song by Bialik, you know, the Jewish national. So, it seems there's a lot of sympathy. I mentioned Salem, A.B. Salem, who was active later in the emigration of the Jews from Cochin, and he met Ben Zvi, S.S. Cohen, I remembered, and he has, that's very interesting. It's after he left the Theosophical Society and was resided in Ramana's ashram. He writes an article, Shimon Lev was the first that sent me this article, about, you know, an enthusiastic article about the importance, it was in the 50s, of the new Jewish state and the effort, etc., etc. So in large, I can think of one who was critical of Zionism, so it's not all overboard, but I think there seems to be, I didn't want to get too much into it, but again, I think there are the similarities of seeing in Kabbalah, seeing that as a way of, a means for Jewish, or content for Jewish national revival. And of course, the context here is this differentiation between Kabbalah and Rabbinic Judaism. Rabbinic Judaism was perceived as a sort of obstacle for Jewish revival, and Kabbalah as a sort of stimulant for Jewish nationalism. And that is exactly the same point that Scholem and Buber had. So from that point of view, by the way, another example, one of the articles of Pia Muller, the Jewish philosophist from Trieste, she translates Buber article into English, Buber's article on Jewish mysticism, and of course Buber writes it from a Zionist perspective. So there's a lot of...
It's another aspect in that the philosophical lines, you also like for a better society, and at least in the early ages was very easy to see, to look at Zionism as kind of something that going toward a better society and with personal moral development, and that scored very well with the line of theosophy.
Yeah. And also in the South African,
that
we'll mention.
There was this guy that came from South Africa in the early 1940s, 1950s, I don't remember his name, but I sent you this. And he tried to establish here also that he wrote these two books, South Africa.
Okay. But also your Kallenbach.
There were Zionists, the Kallenbach, and that's important. They were very much.
Yeah, I think just to answer also your question, that between Zionism and, let's say, Kabbalistic theosophy or theosophical Kabbalah, there is one resemblance. It is a kind of a post-assimilationist neo-romantic Judaism. And in the case of Bergmann and Müller, you can see this very clearly. They looked for something which is a new Jewish truth, and they could form it both. The one is, has a little more political aspect, the other one is actually, let's say, the metaphysical founding of the political side. So this went very well together. I will speak a little bit in the case of Müller about this aspect. My question, thanks a lot for this wonderful survey on this whole, let's say, Jewish theosophy and Kabbalah's Jewish theosophy. It's really convincing. I want to ask about the sources. On the one hand, there is the claim that theosophy and Kabbalah come from the same source. This is the claim of your texts. I would be interested in, you said on the other hand about the sources they used, on what basis they come to this conclusion. I mean, of course, this is a speculative conclusion, but on what basis? You said they rely on Christian Kabbalists, or more, even more on Christian Kabbalists than maybe on Jewish Kabbalist traditions and texts.
Okay.
And of course, you mentioned always this, the example of the Idra Rava and Idra Sutta. This, of course, refers to Knorr von Rosenroth and the whole reading of Knorr von Rosenroth's Latin translation of these parts of the Zohar. I think this is the well-known line that goes into Scottish masonry and ends up in Blavatsky. But I would be interested in if you can name more such lines that can be isolated.
Of their source of knowledge on Kabbalah?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's interesting.
Kind of a typology, well, because the Zohar, I think this can be understood because there has been a Latin translation which helped a lot to promote an esoteric reading of the Zohar.
Okay.
So I think without Knopf and Rodenroth, all this wouldn't have existed.
Definitely.
To a certain extent. Yeah. I think we can say it like this.
Well, it's a complicated question because, first of all, it's not the conclusion. I think that's the assumption that, as Jews, they were of course more interested, and you know, their ambition was to. Now, it's not that difficult because I think their, you know, Kabbalah did originate in Judaism. So you know, the question is, should go about the distancing of Kabbalah from Judaism, but they didn't do this move. On the other hand, they were based. Most of the knowledge of Kabbalah is based on Blavatsky. Other sources. As I said, they didn't study Kabbalah at home. Even A.D. Ezekiel, who was able to be in contact with Kabbalists who taught them later and gave him some books, which he said were terribly difficult for him to read, of course. But most of them encountered Kabbalah through esoteric sources, theosophical sources, scholarly literature at the time, which emerges, part of them written by them, and some of them had knowledge of Hebrew and Aramaic, like Miller, like Bergman, like A.D. Ezekiel. So there were some who turned back to Jewish sources. There's one interesting case of, I mentioned him, Gewürz, who translated many texts. He was from a rabbinic family. He lived in Dembitz until he was 20, so he had some kind of training in Hebrew, and he translates a lot of Zoharic passages. None of those passages are found in the Zohar. There's a very nice quotation of Sholem, but I didn't think about that.
I mean, just smartly, like the case of Müller is interesting because he says he doesn't know Aramaic at a certain point in his memoirs. He says, oh, sorry, I don't know Aramaic. And I think he just used Jean de Pauli's French translation. For let's say this was his main help, and of course he had maybe a Hebrew translation or something like that, but it was not the philological.
Definitely, that's a bit later. Translation of Pauli was very influential because it was, I think, the first comprehensive translation of the Zohar into a European language.
Yeah. And just a small other question: and Eliphas Levi played a role.
Eliphas, I don't think they read him directly.
Okay.
They know him through Blavatsky. I didn't see anyone really mentioning. I don't think I saw any mention of Eliphas Levi. And again, of course, they try to emphasize more the Jewish sources,
even if
they get them through esoteric sources. Mm.
I would like to add a commentary. I think you raised a very important question. Who is a theosophist? Well, we have those people who join a society, who are members in a circle, that's quite clear. I know, for example, Ernst Bloch in Germany, who says in his letters that he was inclined deeply to theosophy, but in his books you never find it. So you have theosophists who are in a period of their life, they are inclined and others not, and well, theosophical thinking remains in his work. Gershom Scholem might be a similar case. So perhaps we had to open our concept of membership, adherence, I don't know what.
Yeah, definitely, there's a wider sphere of influence. And Scholem, to a certain extent, he read those books. He was very disparaging, but also in the case of Imbert was very disparaging on the one hand. On the other hand, he adopts all the theosophical terms. Yeah, he calls the Hasidim, the Tzaddikim are the Mahatmas, and you know, so he uses the terms, and he calls the Kabbalists Jewish theosophies. So you're definitely right, there's a larger sphere of influence, not only people, and there were members of the Theosophical Society that were less influenced and less interested in Kabbalah, of course. So, definitely, I agree.